So in the last class we had looked at the need for actuators, and the operation requirements that one may expect. So, and we saw the different varieties of actuators, pneumatic or hydraulic, and then electric. What are the advantages that one has with respect to another? And then we therefore said that there are a lot of advantages to having electric actuators. And electric actuators are of different varieties. For the case of robotic applications, we usually say that these are electric motors. And these are of different varieties. There are, you have electric machines or electric motors that generate rotational motion. And then you have electric motors that have basically linear motion. Usually when we talk of electric motors, this is what we refer to. This variety is rather rare. It is rather rare and not very much used in industry. And therefore, our discussion will be more focused on motors that produce rotational motion. But if the end effect that you want is not rotational motion, you want something to move along a straight line, then appropriately you use mechanical linkages or a mechanical, an accessory mechanical system to ensure that a rotational motion gets converted into a motion that is linear, right? So that can always be done. For example, if you are looking at your automotive application, right? In the automobile, you have, you know, the windshield. Windshield is what you see in front, and you have blades that are going to remove the dust from the windshield. That has an oscillatory operation. Oscillatory in the sense, a sort of reciprocating movement goes from one direction to another. Any idea how that is achieved? Yes. So you have, this is actually, this is an oscillatory motion. But this is achieved by having one motor, which is a rotating motor, a rotational type motor. And then there is a mechanical linkage which makes this into an oscillatory operation. Right? So you'll have to use some such mechanical linkage, if you will, in order to get this rotational motion converted into some other kind of operation. But the rotational electric motion, electrical machines are rather easy to use because the area of operation of the machine is really restricted. If you want to have a machine that is going to move all along the length, then you have to do the mechanical construction of the machine over such a large distance. So you do have machines that go on linear operation. So these are sometimes used for material handling applications, and of late people are attempting to have electric locomotives as well. Not yet implemented, but it is at a research level where you have electric locomotives operating on the way on the which use linear motors. So if you then take a if you take electric motors these electric motors have, let us say you have the motor, these motors have an electrical input and generate a mechanical output, and this operation, as I'm not sure if I mentioned last time, this happens in the presence of a magnetic field. And what we essentially need to see, if this is the kind of system that we are going to have and we want a desirable mechanical output from the system, that means you want to make the shaft of the machine rotate in a particular manner that you want. If you want to make it operate in a particular manner that you want, the only thing that you can adjust is the electrical input. There is nothing else in the system that you can adjust, and therefore we are essentially looking at what is it that one can do in order that the input that is fed to the machine is of an adjustable nature, and how one can go about adjusting it in order to get the kind of operation that one is looking at. And as we see that the electrical input could be in some cases an AC input, if the robot is not going to really move away from place to place, then it makes sense to operate it with AC input. But on the other hand, if it is going to be moving, then it may not be very easy to have an AC input like this. In such situations, you may prefer a DC input, simply because energy storage can then be put on the robot itself and storage is available only in the form of DC, right? So you can use it in that manner as well. And therefore, in these few lectures regarding electric actuators, what we will be looking at mainly is how the electric motor is operated and the nature of the circuit that is going to sit here, which will enable you to take whatever supply is available and give it in an adjustable manner to the electric motor to get what you want. Right, this is what we are going to look at, and this block which is going to sit here is essentially a block that is having an electronic circuit, and this has to handle the full electrical input that is going to be given to the machine. So this is a high power circuit. It is high power as opposed to the lower the sort of low power electronic circuit, which is all your analog electronics, your op amps and resistors and the different varieties of electronics that is there, right? As against that, this handles higher output powers. That is why it is called high power. So we will therefore have to have some understanding of what this circuit is, the nature of operation of these kind of circuits, and how it will impact the electric motor. And also, we said that you need to get some desirable operation out of that. which means that the circuit operating it must first of all know what is happening in order that it can impose what is desired. If you don't know what is happening there, how do you know how much adjustment you need to give to the supply? Right? Therefore, in order to have that, there needs to be some information flow going from this end to the circuit, which will then enable it to decide what is it that you must do now to the input given to the motor to get a desirable performance. And therefore, all these kind of systems are basically feedback controlled systems. Right? So you have information that is now flowing back from the output side, and then there needs to be some algorithm based on which you are able to look at what is happening at the output, and then you also know what you want. Depending upon the difference, you must be able to do something. So there is then an algorithm. So you may represent it in this manner, that you have the motor and then you have the power electronics, and this gets a source of power, one may call it source of electrical power, this is what energizes the electric motor, and then you have a shaft which may be coupled to whatever application we want. This now needs to be given an input. So you need to have something here which says how this electronic circuit should act in order that the output performance is achieved. So there is here therefore some controller, and this controller needs to know what is required. So there is a reference. Why it's behaving like this today, and that requires an input from what is happening on the other side. So this is the sort of system. This controller itself could be fairly sophisticated. Maybe you need a digital signal processing unit to implement it, some kind of digital algorithm, whatever you need. And this reference is what is going to tell what you are supposed to be doing, right? So if you are going to be moving a robotic arm to pick up this object from there and you are going to place it somewhere else, then this action of asking the electric motor to rotate, starting from this position, rotate, the hand is lifting up, and then you rotate it further for something to happen and then come down and place it. All this has to be given as the reference, right? Where will this reference come from? This reference has to come from what the robot has to do. Somebody has to decide a priori how the entire robotic system has to be sort of programmed, right? So this comes from a supervisory system that says how the overall system must behave, right? So if you are going to have something that is going to move around in this room, for example, right, and it then needs to locate whether there is an obstacle or not, then move somewhere, then go around in this place and then return back, right? So somebody now has to write an algorithm to find out if there is an obstacle or not. There has to be a sensor that detects the obstacle, And then if there is an obstacle, what is it that you need to do? Which direction you should move? When you should move forward? All that will come in this supervisory system. Finally, after looking at all this environment, you take a decision, yes, move forward. That decision is implemented by this loop that we have shown, right? So the actuator in the entire robotic system, the actuator is the final actuating element. It is not something that is going to involve itself in the decision of what the robot must do, but rather implement the decision of what needs to be done. Okay? So we are then going to look at this end action, how that can be implemented. So this is broadly what we are then going to look at. And as somebody asked me last class, what about the books for understanding this in a maybe a different way? So I would suggest the book called Modern Power Electronics. And AC drives by an author called B.A. Bose. So this is a book that gives a lot of details about how such systems operate and how you can design this kind of system and so on. For our purpose, however, we are not going to go into the level of detail that this book gives. We are looking at a very, very introductory and superficial level, right? So if you want to get into some more understanding, this is probably the book. But I am not really aware of a book that will discuss it at the level that we are going to handle in this course, right? This is what we are going to do, is at a very, very superficial level, and you will not really find a book that deals with it at that level. Right, but however, further information is available here. There is another book called Electric Drives by R. Krishnan. He is another book that you can refer. So this is especially speaks about AC drive, and this book has material on DC drive as well as AC drive. So in order to understand, if you are going to be a sort of system integrator, or you are going to be looking at designing an entire system having a robot, then it is only necessary for understanding the role of the electric machine and the role of the circuit that you are going to put here. How do these things operate, and the basic operational behavior of these things. So that is what we will be looking at in this course. So to go ahead, let's start by looking at a simple electric motor. Electric motors are of different varieties. The simplest to understand the operation is what is called as a DC motor. I'm sure you might have heard about it at some time or the other. And so this then has two basic structural parts. we are of course looking at a rotating machine, and therefore you have one entity called as the rotor, another called as stator. The rotor is the entity that rotates, and stator, as the name implies, is stationary. Okay, so you have the stator page. So the stator is a cylinder right with so you have a cylinder with a hole all through. And the rotor is another cylinder that is inserted into this. So this member, the outer member, which is called as I said, stator, is fixed in some way to a base. You may put a bolt and fix it, and therefore the stator is stopped from rotating, and this member which is inside, this is then called as the rotor. The rotor is free to rotate, and your application, whatever you are going to connect, is then connected to a shaft which extends from the rotor. It may not be as long as I have drawn, but there is a shaft which extends from the rotor, right? So the basic idea of operation of the machine is very simple and stems from the simple laws of physics, which I'm sure you are all aware of. The simple law of physics is that if there is a magnetic field that is going to be there, let us say you have magnetic field that is oriented along the directions of the arrow that I have drawn, and then you have an electrical conductor that is located in the magnetic field. That means I am saying that the magnetic field exists in this space, which is going from up to down, and in that you have a conductor that is located like this. Field is going this way, you have a conductor oriented like this, and in this conductor, if you have, let us say that you have a flow of electricity. This is flowing in this direction. So you have the field flowing from up to down. You have a conductor and you have a flow of electricity that is coming out of the conductor in this manner. Right? If this is the arrangement that is there, then we know from basic electrical, that is basic physics, that I can say this is a electrical conductor. Having flow of current, then this conductor experiences a force. It experiences a force. Does somebody remember the equation linking force to the magnetic field to the conductor. BIL. So the force is actually given by I into DL cross I into DL cross B is the equation. So if you have a situation where, as I have drawn, the field is going from up to down, you have this electrical conductor located here. How is the angle? How much is the angle between the magnetic field and this conductor? Equal to 90 degrees, and therefore this means I into DL multiplied by B into sine of the angle between them, which is sine 90 degrees, and therefore this reduces to simply I into DL into B. This is the force experienced by a small length of the electrical conductor DL. But if you are going to have a situation where all along the region of the magnetic field the conductor is in the same direction, right, then the net force that is experienced is simply I into L into B, where L is the length of the conductor, right. So this is your familiar equation, B into I into L. Right, so this is fairly simple, and this is the basis of all electrical machine operation. Right, so the laws of physics based on which motors are built is very, very simple. Now, therefore, if you can somehow make a field exist inside the machine that, let us say, goes like this, comes out this way, goes through this one, and then comes out this way. Similarly, you make another field, or you make a field exist that goes this way. So this field line then goes around like this, closes. This goes around like this and closes. Right? So effectively then, as far as the rotating member is concerned, it is going to see field lines coming down from the stator in this direction, and field lines going out in this direction. And therefore, if you sit on the rotor and look at the space around you, you see lines of magnetic field that are entering from somewhere and leaving from somewhere. And therefore, you would imagine that you have a source of field which is there outside, for which North Pole is sitting here and South Pole is sitting here. Right, you see that North Pole is the region from which field exits, right, and therefore that is a place where it's exiting and it's entering somewhere. So you would think that there's a North Pole here and South Pole here, and I am sitting right in the middle, right. Now, therefore, since you have established a magnetic field that is going to go like this and it is going to go like this, right, it is a situation very similar to what we have drawn there. There is a region now having magnetic field. And now in this space, if you now locate an electrical conductor, so let me draw the conductor here. I place a conductor here that is going to run all along the length of the rotor. I also place another conductor here which is going to run all along the length of the rotor, along the axial length of the rotor. And then let us say I make a flow of current happen such that it is dot here and cross here. If I draw a circle and represent here by a dot, it means that the flow of current is out of this. And if I put a circle and represent it this way, it means the current is flowing in to that. If this is the case, how will the force be experienced by this conductor? Which direction will be the force? You have field lines going from top to bottom. you have a conductor sitting there with flow of current outside. So dl is a vector that is going along the direction of I, that is outside. B is down. So idl cross B is idl cross B is going to exert a force in this direction. In this direction. How will the situation be in the other conductor? You have the same direction of field, but the flow of I has now been reversed, and therefore you would experience a force in the opposite direction, which is in this direction. Okay. So you now have a cylinder where a force is exerted in this direction at one end, and exactly opposite, if I locate the other conductor, you have a force of acting in this direction. And therefore, how will the cylinder respond? It will begin to rotate. Why it will not move either this side or that side? Net force acting on it is zero. Therefore, there is no horizontal movement of this mass. It will only cause a rotation about the axis. And therefore, this rotor will begin to move. Okay, it will begin to rotate. Rotation is caused. Okay. So, B into I into L. So, if you now look at the way I am going, so we somehow need to have a methodology of allowing a flow of current here and bringing it out into this. So, I have an electrical conductor here going all along the length. If I simply make an interconnection with this conductor and that conductor at the back, then any current that goes in can come out through the other side, right? So that is a very simple arrangement, which means effectively that if you have a cylinder here and that is going to go along the length, then I have a conductor here that goes all along the length of the cylinder, emerges out at this point. I have another conductor that goes all along the length of the cylinder. It emerges at this point. I simply short these two. And therefore, if I have these two as outputs, what I can do is send a flow of current into this. This current travels all along the length and then comes back and goes back into the circuit which I am going to connect here, which will be the source of electric current. Right? So if I do this, then we have already seen that it results in rotation. Okay? So this is the basis of motor operation. Now, this is a force that is existing at this location. In order to cause a rotation, you need this force multiplied by this radius is called force into radius is the mechanical torque. And you have this force which is going to generate one torque. And similarly, that is going to generate another torque, both of them tending to cause rotation in the same direction. And therefore, the net amount of torque is B into I into L into R multiplied by 2. This is the torque that is going to be generated by having these two conductors located in this manner. Right. So then the issue is, how do you generate this magnetic field first? So that is now fairly simple. What you do is, in the region here, right? So the region here, you fill it up with that is you fill it up by having a magnet. If you put a magnet, that magnet is going to generate a magnetic field, right? So that is your source of magnetic field. So you will then have to put another magnet to have symmetry in operation, right? So the magnet above will be arranged in such a way that this face is going to be north and that is south, and the magnet below will be arranged in such a way that this face is S and that is N, which then means that you will have magnetic field generated which will come out of this and go into this, and this will complete the circle in the iron of the stator. Right, so this is very simple, that is going to be there. So now in this equation, therefore, you have B into I, L into R. B is going to be generated, this is going to be generated by having a magnet. L and R are dimensions of the system. So you really can't adjust either B or L or R in operation, right? So you can't meddle with any of them. But however, you can meddle with I, because this I is caused by an external circuit that we have connected here. And this is what is going to result in a flow of current here and then coming out of at this point, right? And therefore, you can do something only with this flow of current I. And the goal, therefore, is if you are going to have an electric motor and you want to control it as per the needs of your of the robotic system, then what you need to control is how much flow of current is there, right? So the question is how to do that. Now, apart from this, there is another phenomenon. Now that if a rotation is going to happen, then there is another law of physics which enters into the picture, which is called as Faraday's law, which says that if you are going to have a magnetic field and some conductor is going to move, then there will be an induced EMF there, right? And you can show that that induced EMF is again equal to B into L into R multiplied by 2 multiplied by omega, which is the speed of rotation, speed of rotational motion, right? So you see that there is an induced EMF. The induced EMF has an expression which looks very similar to that of the mechanical torque which is generated, except that in this place you have I and here you have omega, and therefore you can write an expression for the developed amount of torque as some number k multiplied by I. You can write an expression for the induced EMF as the same number k multiplied by speed. Okay. And this law also has an accompaniment which is called Lenz's law, which says that the direction of induced EMF is to so as to oppose the reason why it is there. And the reason why it is induced EMF is there is that these conductors are attempting to move. And why these conductors are attempting to move is because there is a flow of amperes I. And therefore, this induced EMF will attempt to oppose the flow of I. Right? So, looking at all this, one can therefore develop a simple equation describing the electrical aspect of the DC motor, you are going to apply an input voltage V, and this input voltage V results in a flow of current I, which is going to flow in these two electrical conductors. So if there is a flow of current in an electrical conductor, this conductor obviously has some resistance to it, and therefore this V has to be equal to the flow of current I multiplied by the resistance. But that's not all. There is an induced EMF now existing which is opposing this flow of current. Therefore, V equal to I into R plus K into omega. Right? So this is a very simple equation describing the electrical part of the machine. The machine has a mechanical part as well, which says that the developed mechanical torque, it's actually called electromechanical torque, is equal to K multiplied by I. Right? So these two equations then together describe everything about this machine. Right? In response to this torque, you have a rotating mass which is going to move. Rotating mass means the moment of inertia, etc., all those things which are there. Why? Right. So you are applying an input voltage V, and this induced EMF is opposing that V, and therefore the difference will result in a flow of current I, which is I into R. Okay? I just wrote it on the other side. So now this is going to result in movement. Which has, you know, inertia, other opposing forces. And so on. So it has to overcome all that and then start rotating. Right? So now therefore, what we need to understand is how one can do some control on this. Usually when you talk of a DC motor, I'm sure you might have seen small DC motors which you excite with low power DC sources, right? You supply a nice DC voltage to it, the motor starts rotating. Right? Now the question is, looking at these expressions, you may say that you want to supply a DC voltage to the motor. What you normally mean by DC motor, what generally is implied, is that if you draw a waveform of this voltage V as a function of time, I'm talking about this voltage, and then you draw with respect to time. If one says it's a pure DC voltage, what you would expect is a graph that looks like this. This is a pure DC voltage. So if you say, for example, 100 volt DC, then I would say that this is equal to 100. And for all time, it remains exactly at 100 volts. That is pure DC. So one can supply this kind of a DC voltage to the motor, in which case you would expect that if you draw a graph of I with respect to time, then you would expect that this graph is also flat. If you draw some amount of flow of current, maybe 5 ampere, 6 ampere, whatever, some current will flow. But out of the two, having an applied voltage that is flat and having a flow of I that is flat, which one is more important? Which one is more important? Is it necessary to have a flat voltage profile like this? Is it necessary to have a flat flow of current like this? Why would you say that you need a flat current? Torque will otherwise fluctuate, and that electromagnetic torque is the one that is going to result in motion, and you want the motion to be nice and smooth. You don't want an oscillatory motion, right? So you would like the input current to be a flat profile. It is not essential that the voltage also needs to be flat, right? So one needs to therefore look at maintaining the flow of current I to be as flat as you can allow, right? This is where what we discussed in the last class enters the picture, that it may not be feasible to keep it like that. It may be feasible only to keep it like this. Why? We will discuss as we go along, but that is what may be feasible. And if that is what is going to happen, then this I multiplied by K is going to give you electromagnetic torque, which will also be like that. So the question is, what is this amplitude that is allowable for you for the particular application at hand, and what is the frequency that is allowed for the particular application at hand? Given any application, right, you should always be able to determine a high enough value of the frequency such that the mechanical system is immune to that. Right, if you have a mass and you go on hitting it at small amplitude at high frequency, after some time it will just not respond. Right, so one needs to therefore determine what is this and what is this. How do you get it? Why should you go for this kind of an operation? Why is it that we are not able to get this, a smooth DC waveform, right? So all these we will see in the next class. We will stop here.